Good morning, everybody. Welcome this morning. I'd like to invite you to stand with us, and we're going to start right away with a heart of worship. I'd love for you to sing along. To connect with you and connect you to God this morning. And for those of you who don't know, I'm a teacher. I've been teaching for over 20 years, and it's very rare that you would see me standing up in front of my class and lecturing. I like to engage people. So as we sing this next song, I'm going to ask you to kind of step out of your comfort zone. And I'm going to ask you to step across the aisle and welcome somebody this morning. Say hello, shake their hand, say hi. And then could I ask you to come towards the front? You're all so far away in the shadows, we can't see you, those of you who are here. So I'd love for you to just say a hello, welcome somebody, and then come join us up front here. Don't be shy. And I think sometimes it's easy to forget that And I mentioned I was a teacher, and this last couple of weeks I've had several conversations with other teachers, my colleagues, about, to be honest with you, about fear. And my life. We all know fear. I've known fear. And I think it's important to recognize that we feel it, and that circumstances take place that we have no control over. Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword. As it is written, for your sake we face death all day long. We are considered as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen to that. Our God is strong in battle. Our God can chains are broken. that you can lead us through anything, that you are there whether we know it or not, whether we believe it or not, and that you would intercede. Worship night, and if you love to worship, I invite you to come to our next one. It's such a special time of music and praise, but it's a new song, and so we're going to take a moment. But I just invite you to listen to the words and think about the message of the song, because he parted the seas for an entire people to bring them to freedom. And I can only imagine what it must have looked like, right, to see the ocean out in front of you, the waters, and think there's no way out. Until all of a sudden, big, huge walls, just like this aisle, flowing up, and you have the trust again to just walk through. And so I love this song for so many reasons. I hope you enjoy it too.
A God that fights for me. To process that for a little bit. Just for a little bit. God fights for you. Now, when you think about that, a God who fights for you does not hate you. He loves you. How many of us in this morning, in this room, would say that I would fight for any of my loved ones? I'm a dad of three, and I know there's a lot of fathers here. We're going to celebrate you next week, but we'll talk about that later. But we fight for our kids. We fight for our spouses. Scripture would describe Jesus as a loving Savior. A loving Savior doesn't lead people astray. A loving Savior brings people into freedom, into restoration, into salvation. I don't know about you, but that just brings a lot of excitement and a lot of hope. Amen. Hey, you may be seated for a few moments. We're going to start off with the child dedication this morning. And it's something that brings great joy when we bring children to Jesus. One might ask, well, why don't we baptize? Why don't we do the water baptism for a child? Because we believe as a church that baptism in water is a choice that you make after salvation. But I'm going to ask the Gomez family to start making their way forward. Come on, somebody. I asked Jerry and Anna the other day, I was like, two, right? Anna said she wants four. Come on, somebody. Hey, we believe that children are a gift from God, and all parents said, even though they're expensive, even though they cause gray hair, even though they cause emotional roller coasters throughout the day, they are a gift from God. And because they are a gift from God, we as parents have the opportunity to treat them as such, and then to raise our children in a way to where Jesus is at the forefront of our homes. We see throughout Scripture what children mean to Jesus. The moment where Jesus is teaching and the disciples, all the adults in the crowd are like, hey, children, calm down. And Jesus has to stop in the middle of his teaching to say, hey, the kids are just as important. As a matter of fact, if you don't have childlike faith, you don't make it into heaven. And we as parents have the opportunity to foster that into our kids. To have childlike faith into a God who loves and fights for us. So parents and godparents, this morning I'm going to ask you a series of questions. And don't just answer them to answer them. Answer them by reflecting in your heart what it is. He's ready, bro. He's going to be the preacher here in the next few years. Question number one. Do you receive this child with gratitude as a gift for you and your family? Do you guys receive a godson as a gift for you and your family? Come on. This goes for all four of you. Do you commit to each other as parents and as godparents to create a stable environment in which this young man can mature? Will you make a covenant to strengthen your marriage and your relationships? Yes. Do you commit as parents and godparents to live out a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, not so that the child can see a pattern, but he can observe a relationship? Do you commit to lead your homes in such a way where Jesus is at the center of it? Last question. And here's the one that, like, we need to pray about, right? Because these are the good ones. Do you commit as parents and godparents to have patience, to recognize the inherent strengths and weaknesses, and that your desire is to shape and love the child at all times, to pray with the child at all times, to speak about God's word with the child at all times, so that the child can understand that the relationship is that much more important? Yeah, awesome. Now, here's the cool thing about this one. He's number 3 in the lineage. Come on, somebody. For those of you guys who are juniors, it's special. But when you're a 3rd, whew, you're carrying lineage. You're carrying a legacy. Church, can you stand with me? We're going to pray to bless a family. Pastor Sam, I'm going to ask you, you can come up here and just anoint the parents and the godparents. And then just cover them. You ready? I'm right here. I got you. I might be out of practice a little bit, but I'm not going to drop you. All right. Cool deal. Ready? Church, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning with hearts full of gratitude. And we dedicate this child unto you. Not only, God, as an act of gratitude, but as an act of service. That you bless Jerry and Anna, God, in their home. That you fill it with your Holy Spirit, with your abundance, God, with your grace and with your love. We also pray over the godparents, that you continue, God, to bless their home, that they are available to this young man at all moments of his life. And then we pray for this young man, God, that you use him immensely to carry out the gospel of Jesus Christ throughout all of the world. We pray this in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Church, we said, amen, 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 and amen. Can I get him back? I can't see. No? All right. I'll trade you. You go, Dad, and I'll take these. Thanks, buddy.
Use two hands. Use two hands. He's a strong.
Got him. Got him. Oh, yeah. Awesome. Church. Can we just celebrate a little bit? Children are precious. We believe as a church that family is important. Can we just welcome? I want to get this right. Jerry Gomez III. Come on, somebody. Hi, buddy. Yeah. We love you, okay? As a church, we believe in you. And thank you guys for the opportunity. You guys are dismissed. I guess I don't know how this works. You guys can go back. And we'll go with God on that one. Family, it's really important that we come to understand why God gifts us children. God doesn't gift us children so that we can grow our body just amongst ourselves. God gifts us children so that we can continue to grow the kingdom. And I love the portion of scripture that says children are like arrows in a quiver. Point them to where they need to go. We believe as a church that we are called to connect all to Christ by reaching, discipling, and sending. Can't wait for my kids personally to be 18 so I can send them to the other side of the world so they don't come to my bed no more. Pray for me, church, you know what I mean? Hey, if you got your Bibles this morning, and I hope you do, or your iPads, or whatever you guys use to get into the Word of God, we're going to be in a portion of Scripture that is exciting. As I read and reflected on this portion of Scripture, I started to fall in love with Revelation chapter 7. Young people, I think you guys have class. You guys are dismissed. Sorry, Jalen, I know that you got a little impatient. There we go. Revelation chapter 7, like I was saying, it's a portion of Scripture that I started to fall in love with. Again, if we continue the conversation about the book of Revelation, the majority of Christians have a really interesting relationship with this book. We either love it because we fully understand what it is, or we fear it because in it we know that there's a lot of imageries or a lot of signs, and we get to this place where, like, if I fear it, I'm not going to read it. But can I encourage us this morning as a church to fall in love with the book of Revelation? Revelation is simply a book of hope. It gives a believer this sense of, wow, this is what I'm put on earth for. It gives us a moment to reflect on the goodness of God. It gives us a moment to reflect on these things need to happen because they're a part of God's plan. And because they are part of God's plan, we can come to understand that God has everything under control. And we all said, we got to understand that one. Because sometimes in life we can say, God, like, what's happening here? What's going on here? But God has everything under control. Thank you, Marcy. This is what the Word of God says. Revelation chapter 7, verse 1. After this, I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth. What does it say? Restraining the four winds of the earth so that no wind could blow on the earth or on the sea or on any tree. Like, I want us to stop there for a little bit because we live in Othello, Washington, and it's windy 95% of the day. That's what it feels like anyway, you know what I mean? So imagine walking outside one day out of our beautiful landscape here with no wind. Kind of strange, right? Verse 2 and 3. Then I saw another angel rising up from the east who had the seal of the living God. He cried out in a loud voice to the four angels who were allowed to harm the earth and to the sea, "Do not harm the earth or the sea or the trees until what? We seal the servants of our God on their what?" I want you to get the imagery here. Four angels holding back the wind over all the earth. One angel saying, "I know that you guys can release the wind and harm the earth, but don't. There is a plan and there is a purpose." Verse 4. "And I heard the number of sealed, 144,000 sealed from every tribe of the what? Israelites. 12,000 sealed from the tribe of Judah, from the tribe of Reuben, from the tribe of Gad, from the tribe of Asher, from the tribe of what? Naphtali. From the tribe of what? Manasseh, Simeon, Levi, Issachar. And who's the last one? Now, for those of you guys who are great mathematicians, what's happening here? You sure there's 12? You counting them? Okay. 12 times 12, 144,000. Here's where it gets good. "After this, I looked, and there were a vast multitude from every nation, tribe, people, and language, which no one could number, standing before the throne and before the Lamb. They were clothed in white robes with what? Palm branches in their hands. And they cried out in a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to whom? Our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb.'" And we all said, all the angels stood around the throne, and along with the elders and the four living creatures, they fell face down before the throne and what? Talk about that here in a bit. Saying, "Amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and strength be to our God forever and ever." And we all said, "Amen." Then one of the elders asked me, "Who are these people in the white robes? And where did they come from?" I said to him, "Sir, you know." Then he told me, "These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. They washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, They are before the throne of God, and they serve him day and night in his temple. The one seated on the throne will what? When we know that God has everything under control, we know that God has everything under control. They will no longer hunger. They will no longer thirst. The sun will no longer strike them, nor will any scorching heat. For the Lamb who is at the center of the throne will what? Will guide them, shepherd them, care for them, love on them. He will guide them to springs of waters of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Heavenly Father, we come again before you this morning with hearts full of gratitude. And we thank you that we can come to study your word. Holy Spirit, open our hearts, open our minds, and speak to us this morning. And we name your pray. We all said, amen. You may be seated. Interesting, no? Chapter 7 is a little different from the first six chapters of Revelation. It's like if John came to understand there needs to be this pause moment, there needs to be this rest moment, there needs to be this moment of reflection. Now, I'm going to ask you guys a simple question, and maybe you can help me understand this a little bit. But have you ever been part of a selection process? For example, anybody play school sports during recess? As a matter of fact, when school sports happen during recess, usually two things happen, right? There's two captains. Yes? Help me out here. There's two captains. And those two captains are usually the guys or the girls who are a lot better at that sport that's about to be played than the rest of us. If you can relate to the rest of us part, praise the Lord, glory, hallelujah. If you were the captains, I love you guys. But believe it or not, I was always on the top three of the bottom to get selected. Scripture says if you want to be at the top, you got to start at the bottom. So that's the way I look at it. You know what I mean? And it was always an interesting thing because you stand there and you're nervous for two things. You're nervous to play and you're nervous to get selected. And all these emotions happen and all these things happen because there's a reason for these things to happen. Understand, as Christians, we believe that there's going to be a great rapture. The great rapture consists of Jesus coming for his bride, the church. And that before tribulation happens, we are going to be up there in paradise with Jesus. Yes? If not, we're going to talk about why the struggle of yes this morning. There's two great groups here. John is giving us a clear image about why tribulation needs to happen. There's a reason for this. And it's not so much the end of times. And I want to argue that fact this morning with you. It's the beginning of something. It's the beginning of God coming onto this earth, releasing his wrath, releasing plagues for 7 years. A lot of famine and a lot of hurt and a lot of pain is going to happen during those 7 years of tribulation. And I know it's scary. And I know that we can be like, well, if God really loved people, then why would he allow these things to happen? If God really was a gracious and loving and merciful Father, then why allow the 7 years to happen of great tribulation? And there's a reason for this. Tribulation needs to happen because it's part of God's plan, number one. Can I emphasize what we talked about this morning? God is in control of all things. And if God is in control of all things, you have to understand that we know that there is a specific plan for tribulation. As a matter of fact, the study would say this: the tribulation is a period of historical change. God uses these 7 years to bring the church age to a close. I asked a question this morning to one of our members, and I go, I have a theological question for you. And we would sit there and we would have the discussion, and the theological question was this: do you belong to the 144, or do you belong to the vast multitude? One of those questions we have to ask. Do we belong to the 144 or do we belong to the vast multitude? Now, the trick question. Because the trick is, the answer is neither. We neither belong to the 144 or we neither belong to the vast multitude. For those of us who have committed our lives to Christ, if we are a part of the church, we are in relationship, we are being made whole, being made right, then we believe that we are in the church age now, that God is using us to be part of his bride so that when the rapture comes, we are then raptured with him. So then who are these people? And why does the tribulation then need to happen? Again, it's the end of the church age. The 7-year period links to the past 6,000 years from Eden until the millennium and for 1,000 years after. In the tribulation, God takes a big step towards his final judgment on sin, sinners, and Satan. The purpose that needs to happen. But here's the cool thing about this. That the great tribulation will lead us to the return of the one true king. There's hope, church. But here, now, we can sit here and we can debate all day about, hey, if I don't get raptured, I still have hope. But can I argue something with you? I don't think that we should hope for the tribulation to happen before we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior. I don't. I believe that we have the opportunity today to commit our lives to Jesus, that we have the opportunity today to be made whole, to be made right, to be sanctified and be made whole. I believe that today is a day of salvation because Scripture would remind us of this and encourage us of moments like this. It would be like a father directing his son not to go that way because it's going to harm him. And yet his son makes a decision for harm. Any dads, can you relate? Yeah? No? Maybe? Pray for me, church, because then my kids need Jesus. If your kids are perfect, write books. I'll read them. But the purpose is so that we can come to know that Jesus is the one true king. Tribulation, it causes great trouble and it causes great suffering. And I want us to stop there because oftentimes when we read the book of Revelations, we stop here. We'll go through the first six because the first six chapters are for the most part great. It leads us into hope. It leads us into acts of worship. It leads us into understanding that only Jesus is worthy to hold God's plan and break the seals. But when it comes to moments of tribulation, a lot of us want to step back. And the reality is we step back because none of us, I believe, like to go through any sort of pain. Nobody. We don't like to go through stormy seasons in our life. We don't like when God brings moments of testing in our lives. We don't like to undergo the struggles of that pain. But understand that in the moments of tribulation, in the 7 years of tribulation, pain is going to be real. Hardship is going to be real. For those who have dedicated their lives to Christ. Now, we think about that and what that looks like because as we finish chapter 6, there's a question that's asked at the end of chapter 6. Who is worthy to stand? In chapter 7, we're then give us the answer of those who are worthy in the moments of tribulation to stand and continue to share the good news of Jesus. It talks about the 144,000 who are coming from the 12 tribes of Israel, and it talks about the vast majority. But we come to understand that God changes the earth to change people's attitude towards him. How many of us would not fight for our loved ones? How many of us would not give everything for those whom we love with everything? As a matter of fact, as a father, I try to practice that every day. To give up my selfish desires and my selfish needs. Can I just illustrate that, what that looks like? Tuesdays and Thursdays from 4:45 to about 6:30. Allow my kids to play baseball. And I don't think they're playing anything. I think they're playing with dirt more than time. They're learning the positions of how to be out there in the field. But I'm going to be honest with you. And I've had this conversation with my wife. It hurts me. It hurts me because I love my afternoons. As a matter of fact, it hurts me so much that those who are around me, I kind of confess and share that with them. I don't know, Merle. I think I can wait till they're in middle school to play sports. And someone will remind me, this is only the beginning, Larry. And I go, what do you mean it's only the beginning? I feel like it should come to an end today. But then I realize what's happening in the moments where my kids are out there participating in the activity. I remind myself of what it is to be involved in a team with one goal in mind, to be involved in a community with the mission of winning. You know what that reflects, church? Can I be honest with you this morning? That reflects the church. If scripture would remind us that we are a multitude of people in one body with Jesus at the head going one way, the world is going to try to reflect everything God will reflect. As a matter of fact, this is what is interesting about the tribulation. During the tribulation time, God in his perfect will, in his perfect plan, will have things set up for the people who are here, the 144,000, those who come back to Christ. Scripture would say that he's going to mark them on their forehead. But when we think about Revelation, the mark on the forehead, the first thought we don't think about is the one coming from God. What's the one we think about? The beast. The mark of the beast, the mark from Satan, the mark from the Antichrist. Why is that, church? It's because, again, I believe that we sometimes come into this book with a fear-first mentality. When all throughout Scripture, can I emphasize this? All throughout Scripture, God would remind us, do not be afraid, for I am with you, and I will never forsake you. As a matter of fact, I don't give you the spirit of fear, but of what? A sound mind, self-control, power that is given to you via the Holy Spirit. So we have to come to understand this truth. That in the moments of tribulation, God has a plan, but so does Satan. And what Satan's plan from the beginning of creation is, or even before that, was to be an imitator of God. Now, here's the cool thing about that thought. Now, I shouldn't say a cool thing, but it's an interesting thing, because if you think about Satan imitating God, then one can argue the fact that Satan has never had an original thought for himself. God created worship through music and through voice. Yeah. Satan would create worship through music and through voice that doesn't glorify God. God would say, hey, I have a system in place to where a plethora of people or a multitude of people from all walks of life can come and sit together and hear the word and hear the truth. And Satan would try to mimic that. God would say, I'm going to put a seal on my people, on my children. Romans would remind us, for those who are found in Christ, we are God's child. We are sealed. So Satan would say, if God can give a seal, I can give one too. And what God creates for wholeness, goodness, and restoration, Satan's seal would be selfish and destructive. God would say, I'm never going to give you anything that you can't handle. Scripture would say that, right? Satan would say, I'm going to give you everything so it feels like you can't handle it. The tribulation comes in, and what happens here is that we have to come to understand this is God's plan. This is God's course for the world. And when it's God's course for the world, we can't let moments like this that we're going through today just passes by. Because it's moments like this, church, that we start to get empowered by the Holy Spirit to continue to preach the good news throughout those who would listen to it. It gives us hope. And it not only does it give us hope for today, it gives us hope for tomorrow. And it gives us hope that we can continue to have a relationship with the God of the universe. So in the moments of tribulation, we have to understand this. God removes the beauty, the pleasures, the health, the security from the earth so that we can be found in him. And if we are found in him, God will call all of those who choose him to be saved in the moments of tribulation. Now again, we mentioned the two groups. Those are who are sealed in the vast, the multitude. Now, if I'm going to teach a little bit here. You give me permission? Praise the Lord. Thank you. The two groups. The first group numbers 144,000. It's made up of the 12,000 individual tribes of Israel. Now, you have to understand that Israel is God's chosen people from the very beginning. They were part of the plan. And why that matters is because it matters. Through them, we have scripture. And not only do we have scripture, we have scripture passed down from generation to generation so that at 11:55 a.m. on a Sunday morning, we, who are not Jewish people, unless you are, praise the Lord, glory, hallelujah, can sit here and talk about the truths given to us through the scripture of God. They're important because through them also comes our Savior, Jesus Christ. He comes through the tribe of Judah. Right? Why chapter 4 would say, turn around, look at the Lion of Judah, and he would be postured as a lamb. Understand that Jesus Christ comes through the Jewish people. And because he comes through the Jewish people, God is not done with them yet. Now, I want us to process this in real time. Who was it that denied Jesus and his divinity? Scripture would say his own people. So in that, we who are Gentiles or therefore considered Gentiles have the opportunity for salvation. And when we have the opportunity for salvation, we come to understand that God is on the move. And when God is on the move, there's a plan and a perfect will that comes through Jesus. So they're there. And they're not done yet. Who the 144,000 are people who all their lives have been taught that Jesus is just a great teacher. Nothing more, nothing less. He had great messages. He had a great example of what life looks like, but that's it. Tribulation hits. The rapture comes, tribulation hits. 144,000 Jewish people will turn to accept Jesus as Lord and Savior, as the true Messiah. Now, when they turn to accept Jesus as the true Messiah, here's the great thing about all of this, that they will become bold evangelists to the rest of a suffering world. Now, Scripture talks about two prophets who are going to come and evangelize throughout all the world, and they're going to hear the message at one time, and we're going to get into those lessons later, but you come to understand, what does it really take for someone to recommit their lives or to change the narrative of everything that they've been taught since they were young to understand whom Jesus truly is? If all your lives you were just taught that Jesus is this guy that you hear about on a Sunday morning or on a Wednesday, and he did good things, and he might have done miracles, but that's it. Understand, church, today that Jesus is our Savior because Jesus is the one true Messiah who lived, who died, who resurrected, who ascended, who sent the Holy Spirit so that we can live empowered to continue to share the good news of who he is to all the world. So where it works, in moments of confusion, in the moments of doubt, God still has a plan for his gospel message to move forward. And I don't know about you, church. Like, there's some times where it's like, you're sharing, you're living it out, and the question sometimes is, am I getting through, or is it working? Or am I enough? Or am I doing enough? Am I saying enough? Am I reading enough? Am I praying enough? What does this look like? Can I come to this realization this morning, church? God loves you. He fights for you, not because you're enough, but because he's more than enough. And the Jewish people who give their lives to him, the 144,000 Jewish people, come to understand that truth. It's like turning on a light in a dark room. I can see. Scripture says that I was once blind, but now I see. Imagine the elation, the celebration. Whatever it takes now, I'm going to dedicate my life to Jesus. And when God seals them, God protects them. God covers them. You know what the great thing about being and living in the time of grace and mercy in the church age? That we are covered and we live in grace and we live in mercy. That we can go on and say, hey, I'm covered because I am a child of God. I am covered because in this, God will give us his presence through the Holy Spirit and we can live empowered, right? Acts chapter 1, verse 8, and the power of the Holy Spirit will come upon you. And you will be my witnesses, not just all believers who sit here and, oh my goodness, today felt like a great Sunday. No, no, you will be my witnesses in Judea, in Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. It's an outward effect, and they come to realize whom this is. Now, here's the amazing part of the second part of the group, the vast. We get a number, for those of you guys who are mathematicians and like data and stats, 144,000. We can see that for the most part, right? 144,000 is like putting a couple of stadiums together and we can, you know, see what that looks like. What John sees next, not even those who were there could count. If there's 8 billion people on the planet in 2022, and out of those 8 billion people, let's just say 1 billion people go up to heaven. Because they're part of the church. Let's do some math real fast. They're part of the church. They are raptured. They go to heaven. That means 7 billion people are still left on this planet who either have not come to fully realize that Jesus is Savior, or perhaps they heard and they didn't fully believe or fully didn't commit. So now they're seeing rapture happening in real time. They're seeing plague after plague after plague happen for 7 years, and then something clicks in them too. Don't want to be a part of this world, because now I've come to understand whom God is, and God is fully in control. A vast multitude which no one could count. Now, being part of the second group church, again, isn't something to look forward to. Pastor would remind us during the first service, it's not something that we hope for. Don't hope to be part of the second group. Again, remember when you were in elementary school, middle school, high school, when you were being picked, no one ever hoped to be the top 3 at the bottom. Nobody. I never hoped. I would always strive to be like the first 3 picked. Like, pick me, pick me. You know, you're doing whatever it takes to get on to the list first. And it's interesting because as churchgoers, I sometimes believe that we're okay with just being okay. I'm okay with just coming to church on a Sunday morning and feeling good about what God has said to me, but I don't know if I can give it all. I'm okay with just giving half the effort, but we're reminded through one of the church letters that if you're being lukewarm, you're going to get spit out and nothing good comes from you. So why is it that we can stay just okay with being okay as a Christian? Jesus never calls us to settle. Jesus never calls us to stay stagnant. Jesus never calls us just to, like, don't do anything. You're good. As a matter of fact, Jesus would call us to live uncomfortable. Jesus would call us to live out this gospel no matter what it takes. Now, we know it's hard. But Pastor, you have no idea what I go through week by week. You have no idea the emotions that my kids bring out of me. Praise the Lord, glory, hallelujah. You have no idea the emotions my spouse brings out of me. Praise the Lord, glory, hallelujah. You have no idea that I read the scriptures and I get completely lost. You have no idea that I pray and I feel like God is not even there. Can I just remind you, time out here. I don't have to know, but God knows it all. And if God knows it all, then our first efforts should be then to go to God. God, hey, I'm going through these things. Because your word says to find refuge in you. Your word says to find solace in you. Your word says to find comfort in you. So our goal should not be to wait for the time of tribulation until we finally accept salvation. When scripture reminds us that today, church, no. Today is the moment of salvation. Today is our opportunity to understand that and God can do whatever it takes to reach somebody. I love the portions of scripture where God interjects. And I'm so grateful that God interjects. Because if God did not interject in my life or in your life, then our testimonies would be completely different. It was everything that I did to come to salvation. It was everything that I did that God loves me. It was everything that I'm doing that I know that I'm going to be in heaven. Can I remind this church? No, it's not. It's not. And because it's not, woo, there's freedom in that, church. We can come to understand like, hey, God, you love me? Yeah, I love you. Are you sure you love me? Oh, you better believe I love you, buddy. Why, God, if I'm not perfect? And God would say, I've made you in my image. I called you son and daughter so that you no longer have to go back to the sin, but that you can chase perfection and be made whole and be made right. I love you, God would remind us. And I love you because my plan for you is that you should be saved. Now we read in John chapter 3, verse 17. We all know 16, right? For God so loved the world that no one would ever die or perish. What's 17 say, church? Remember 17? God did not send Jesus to condemn this world, but to save this world through him. God never wants anyone to perish. That isn't his plan, church. But yet people will. And why people will is because people are sinful by nature. Their hearts get hardened. I think I've shared this testimony a few times here, but if not, I'm going to share it again. There was a period of my life in our relationship where we were trying to have kids. And we lost our first baby. And I'm not even going to lie. For a season in my life, my heart was hardened to God's presence. My heart was hardened to God's love and to God's grace. My heart was hardened to God's will for my life. Not because I didn't fully understand who he was or why he was or how he was or what he wanted from me. It's because I came to understand that what just happened, a loving God cannot do until the Holy Spirit brought clarity into my life. And it wasn't through anything extraordinary or spectacular. It was through people who were just loving on us in that season. And the Holy Spirit would send a couple into our home who would sit with us and cry with us for hours and not say anything. The Holy Spirit would send people into our home with gorditas and some coffee and say, we're here and we love you. The Holy Spirit would send people into our home who brought scripture that reminded us of who God was in this middle of the season. But because of my selfishness, I would reject that love and that affection until I understood the and God moment of that testimony. My dad sits us down and says, it hurts, huh? Yeah, Dad, it hurts. I go, you have no idea. He goes, I don't have to have an idea. Because scripture would remind me that you cry with those who cry and you laugh with those who laugh, as he would tell us. And I would tell Dad, but then why? Why? We've done everything right. Go to church all my life. I mean, I wasn't a perfect kid, but I'm not saying that I was a deacon's kid either. You know what I mean? They're the worst. That's why pastor's kids are shot. And old church jokes, sorry. Why, Dad? And my father, in that moment being my pastor, would remind us that even in the middle of pain, God reaches you. I don't know how many of us have gone through something devastating. Perhaps where we've questioned God's purpose in our life, or perhaps where we've questioned God himself of why. But can I remind you this morning that even in the middle of all of that, he's reaching for you. Process that one, church. No other world religion teaches that there's a God who reaches for his creation. Because all world religion is based on what humans can do to satisfy their gods. But God of the universe, God of the creator, says, no, let me step in into the situation. Let me step in and reveal to you what it looks like for God to be in the middle of it. And then the "and God" moments, God will be like, okay, I got you, right? The 144,000, the grand multitude, there's a purpose and there's a plan. Now here's where, again, I don't want us to get lost in, well, there's still hope if the tribulation comes and I don't go. Don't do that, church. Because scripture will remind us of two things. Either you're going to give your life to Christ in that moment, or your heart's going to be even harder. You're either going to take the seal of God, or you're going to take the seal of Satan, the imitation. But can I remind you of what's going to happen to those who take the seal of God? It's going to get hard. They're not going to be able to eat. They're not going to be able to drink. Scripture says that one of the plagues, that the sun is going to burn extremely hot for a season, and then they're going to be left outside to burn. It's not going to be anything easy. If we think it gets really hot here in Othello, Washington, during the summertime in August for like 2 days, nothing will compare to the pain that will happen to those who believe during the Great Tribulation. But then why? Why would they in moments say, hey, you know what? Whatever it takes, I'm going to go. Because like the 144,000 who become bold evangelists, the vast multitude will also evangelize with their lives of God's love and God's affection for his people. I don't know about you, church, but that kind of brings me this hope and encouragement to not be a part of the second group. You know what I mean? Who do you belong to? I know that I'm not Jewish. I haven't done the whole family tree thing, but I know. I like tortillas hechas de mano, gorditas y café negro. Come on, somebody. Pan dulce every now and then. I'm working on it, okay? Pray for me. But that also reminds me, church, that we have the greatest message in human history. And that is Jesus is enough. Jesus is our Savior. Jesus brings life and hope and restoration. And that Jesus will reach for you and save you if you call out to him, because today is a day of salvation. These people will suffer, and yet God will intervene. God knows every detail of your life. And he cares about it. How do I know? What does verse 16 and 17 say? They will no longer hunger, nor will they thirst. The sun will no longer strike them, nor will any scorching heat. For the Lamb who is at the center of the throne will shepherd them. John chapter 10 reminds us of whom Jesus is, and is Jesus as a good shepherd. Scripture would remind us that a good shepherd loves his sheep, and that his sheep recognize his what? His what? His voice. And when a shepherd leads with his voice, He's leading out front. I want to put this image in your head. When Jesus is leading out front, who do you think all the... I want to put it this way. Who do you think all the bad stuff is hitting first? And if Jesus, fully God, fully man, can endure the things of this world and live a perfect life for those who he's leading, how much more, Jesus would say, you're going to do far greater things. Not that we're going to bring anybody to salvation, not that we're going to save anybody, but we're going to have a further reach because he's leading us. He's guiding us. Now, here's the cool thing about this. He's also leading and guiding those who are part of the vast. That's the "and God" moment. He shepherds them. He will guide them to springs of water of life. Who is the living water, church? Jesus, come to me and you'll never thirst anymore. Come to me and you'll never hunger anymore, because he's also the bread of what? Bread of life. And we come to these understandings. Chapter verse 17 ends like this. He will guide them to the springs of living water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eye. Now in moments, when we think about what God has done for us, where we were yesterday and how God is leading us today, we come to understand that a lot of tears have been shed to get to this moment. But his blood was shed first so that we have the opportunity of salvation. I love it because in chapters, or verse 8 and 9, the elder describes the robes being washed white with blood. An oxymoron. You think about blood stains. Blood does not come out of clothes. And no, Ezra, for some reason, just gets bloody nose all the time, and all his shirts, for the most part, are kind of stained here. No matter how much we scrub, and no matter how much tithe or white out or whatever you want to call bleach, it does not come out. But it's the blood of Jesus that once we have the full understanding of the gospel message in our hearts and in our minds, and we're living it out, that it starts to overflow from us. We are covered by the blood, made white as snow, so that those around us can also hear the message of Jesus. Church, and it's an amazing opportunity to come to understand why salvation happens and whom salvation comes through. So then what can we do? We see chapter 7 and you ask yourself, then why is that relevant to me? Number one, it's relevant to you because, number one, don't be a part of the second group. Don't strive to be, oh, I'm going to wait till I'm 80 years old to ask Jesus into my heart as Lord and Savior. I'm going to wait until I'm 85 to live out as a living sacrifice. You don't have to wait that long. Today, you have the opportunity to say, yeah, Jesus, I'm here. My life belongs to you today. Salvation, I need today. Now, church, I understand that a lot of us have, well, if I give my life to God, what is God going to do with it? Thoughts. Scripture would remind us that those who are found in God, God will bless in abundance. It's a perfect will. It becomes something glorious and to seek after. I heard a preacher ask his church 2 weeks ago, what do you want? Do you want to do whatever you want to do? Are your desires in line with what God has for you? I want to finish asking the same question. What do you want? Would you wait until a perfect day or a perfect season or a perfect moment to give your life completely over to Jesus and God's will and be empowered by the Holy Spirit? Or will you continue to live out the way you're living out right now, half in and half out? And that might not apply to everyone in the room, but it might apply to some. And I want to encourage us today, church, that once we are found in Jesus, considered children of the Most High, friends, co-heirs with Christ, that we are covered and we are sealed, so that no matter what attack comes our way, we can face it, because we know that if we perish on this earth, because we as believers don't love this earth, where will we be found tomorrow? And that is with Jesus in glory. Stand with me, church, as we close. We believe and we're praying for God's Holy Spirit to be poured out on His people. We believe that revival is not something that happened in the past, but that's something that can happen now today, and that it's coming. A great spiritual awakening is not something that is far out of reach. A great spiritual awakening is something that we can experience today if we choose to seek it. And when that happens, we have then the privilege of leading others to the saving grace only found through Jesus. Church, we have a mission, church. We're not all perfect. And I know that sometimes it's scary, because you're like, well, if I try to lead someone to Christ and I don't fully know what to say or how to say it, what's going to happen? And can I remind you, church, all people need is a seed planted. If Jesus can do this for me, imagine what He can do for you. And then we're going to do this together. So I want to pray for a couple of things. Number one, if you're in here this morning and you just want to give your life to Jesus and say, hey, I'm ready to commit my life to Christ, I'm just going to ask you to shoot your hand up and we're going to pray for you. Number two, if you're in here this morning and you feel that you need just to continue this relationship because God has instilled something in you, and that's called the Holy Spirit, and we're just going to live that out. We're just going to pray that can the power of the Holy Spirit continue to empower you to live forward. Amen? So every eye closed and every head bowed, if you are wanting to give your life to Christ, just go ahead and shoot your hand up, and we're going to pray with you this morning. We're just going to celebrate salvation, and then we're just going to pray to God for the power of the Holy Spirit. And thank you, Heavenly Father. We pray for those who have chosen to give their lives to You completely this morning, that salvation come to them today, that You empower them, God, by Your living Holy Spirit. And I pray over the church that we are guided by You, that we are anointed by You to be messengers, bold evangelists of the good news in the gospel of Jesus. That fear no longer be a part of our vernacular, but that grace and mercy be something that we live out constantly and every day. God, we celebrate for those who've chosen to give their lives to You today, God, and we celebrate because we know that You are the one true King. And as believers and as disciples of Jesus, we continue to ask and pray that You lead us, You guide us, and You move us to be more and more like You every day. We pray this in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. And we all said, amen, amen, and amen.
God bless you, church, this morning. Praise the Lord. Is it good to be in the house of the Lord this morning? Yes, it is. Let me give you some announcements for this week. There's the regular announcements. Tuesday morning, we have prayer service for men. I know that if you are not working, I invite you to come over on Tuesday mornings and join the other men of the church. They gather to pray for our community, pray for our families. How many know that our community and our families need prayer? Amen. Wednesdays, normally the women have prayer service at 10, but this Wednesday they have canceled the prayer meeting because they're going to get together and have another activity in town. But normally they do get together. How many are getting the texts in behalf of the church of Pray for America? I love them. you're not getting them, please let Pastor Larry know so we can get your number and make sure you get those. But we're praying for America for the next 30 days from June 5th to July 4th. And there's messages that go out every day indicating what we need to pray for America for. So I know that I need prayer. And if I need prayer, America needs prayer. Amen? Praise the Lord. Bible study this week is on Wednesdays at 6 p.m. We're going to do also the Spanish and the English Bible studies together from now on. So it'll be at 6 this coming Wednesday. So please join us if you have some time to learn about the Word of God. Girls Ministry Camp, they have a camp going on August 5th through the 7th. If you want to register your daughters to go to the Girls Ministry Camp, please see Sister Kimberly or any one of our pastors, and we'll make sure that we get you signed in to go. The Ebenezer Group, anybody over 60? Hallelujah. I'm living my 60th year already, so next year I got to go. I'm not going to have a choice. Now I go by choice, but I'm going to have to go. Hallelujah. Anyway, we have really great Bible studies at 3:30 there at the Lighthouse. Some coffee and some sweet bread that my wife prepares. It's awesome. You don't have to be a part of Ebenezer to go, okay? If you want to go and join us at 3:30, you're more than welcome to do that. And next Sunday is, as Pastor Larry would say, the third most important day of the year. And it's not Mother's Day. It's Father's Day. Woo! Come on now. So we'll celebrate next Sunday, Father's Day. We're going to have one service. So please don't show up at 11. You'll be late. Come over at 9 a.m. to celebrate Father's Day next Sunday and just have a great time with the Lord. We have a special guest that's going to be with us, Brother Eddie Rents. He's one of the directors of Convoy of Hope. Has a beautiful ministry. He's going to be with us. So come and enjoy a great day with everyone here on Father's Day. Subsplash is replacing Pushpay. If you still haven't done your process of change, please see Pastor Larry. Don't see Pastor Sam. I'll send you over there. He knows what to do with that. I'm all set up already, so that's all I can do. But if you need any help with that, please see Pastor Larry. And Right Now Media, how many of us have gone into Right Now Media and gone through some of the devotions? I'm doing the book of Hebrew right now. Wow, that's powerful. Great stuff. It's only 17 to 22 minutes long. It's awesome. Do it if you can. We'll be starting classes for people that want to carry out an actual Bible study in their home or somewhere else they want to gather starting in the fall. But we will be having classes during this summer as to how to go through the whole process, what to do, what not to do, and how to do it so we can do this to perfection and just grow the Church of Jesus Christ. We've heard of these programs that although maybe the attendance to the church doesn't grow on Sunday, the attendance of those knowing more about God grows. And that's the whole purpose, church, to grow the kingdom of God. So we're excited about this program that's coming up, and we just can't wait till it gets going. So let's pray and be dismissed. We're going to give thanks to the Lord for our offerings and tithing. We remind you that there's a place there in the center of the foyer to deposit your offerings. Please do that, your tithings, and then we'll just grow the kingdom of God for his honor and glory. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you because you are good, Father. We worship and we praise your name because you are merciful. It's so good, Lord, to know that your mercies are everlasting. Even after the rapture that you come for your people, Lord Jesus, there's still your mercy there for those that stay behind. I pray, Lord, that we make a commitment as your followers to serve you with all of our heart. Now, Lord, now, so that we might rejoice with you in the wedding feast of the Lamb in heaven, while others are going to be here on earth suffering, maybe accepting you, but going through some hard times. I pray, Lord, that you allow us to give ourselves completely to you and to serve you with all of our heart, that we might be ready for the rapture. I pray, Lord, for the offerings that we're going to be giving this morning in our tithing. Bless them, Lord. Thank you for the many blessings you've given us. And allow us, Father, to be faithful to you with those things that we need to be faithful for. Bless our offerings. Bless our tithings, Father. We ask that you do that in an abundant way for honor and glory. Now dismiss us from this place, Lord, but never from your presence. In the name of Jesus, we ask and pray. And God's people say this morning, Amen, amen, amen. God bless you, church.